So you think you're a 90s fan. Okay, Hannibal Lecter, we got a problem. Can you handle this? It's I Love the 90s, and this is 1991. The Flicks.
I am an FBI agent.
The fashions, the trends, the TV.
Good news, I'm here.
The tunes.
Rico.
A totally awesome year that gave us these burning questions. How'd these short and curlies get all over my favorite beverage?
Who put pubic hair on my coat?
Is it yours?
Was Dylan McKay the oldest high school student ever?
Luke Perry was like the oldest guy on the show. I think he was like the Fonz, and he's banging 16-year-olds.
And will Urkel's gonads ever recover from those hiked-up pants?
We were all looking at Jaleel when he was all dressed up like, we can see your balls.
You're unbelievable.
The answers to those questions, plus Pudgy Cowboy's shout out to his posse.
It's an anthem for his dumb friends. Why don't you just write a song called Dumbass? Yeah!
And Nino Brown, the guy who made Scarface seem like a total wuss.
Ooh, dark, black, and mean.
Because you love the 90s.
Rock and roll.
Because you're still rocking those Bugle Boy jeans.
It's him.
Yes. They are Bugle Boy jeans.
Admit it. This is 1991.
I'm not a crook.
What's up? You have selected.
I love
90210. Sort of. I was just like, wow, that's a world I know nothing about.
I was a big fan of 90210, and I had this beef with Aaron Spelling because there are some rich brothers, man. We could have been in a little bit more of that show.
They needed to make a black version, Compton 90222.
90210 was about a family from Minnesota that moves to Beverly Hills.
This is a show about high school kids and all the mishaps and scrapes they get into.
They all had cars, you know, they had houses on the beach, and just lots of angst.
I spend my mornings in the sun and my afternoons playing volleyball.
Some of these kids might be drinking. Some of these kids might be thinking about having some sex.
I'm 5 days late.
Of these two sexy cats, I was always more of a Brandon girl.
I understand how you feel.
The great Dylan McKay. Who was my favorite?
Luke Perry was like the oldest guy on the show. I think he was like the Fonz, and he's banging 16-year-olds.
His eyes were like this a lot.
They used to have a contest for the sideburns. Luke started here, Jason started here, then they went here. If you look at the episode, you could actually see them.
Brandon Walsh, played by Jason Priestley, had a twin sister, Brenda.
Brenda.
I'm eating my food, having a wonderful time.
She was a raging bitch on the show. You just felt nervous when you saw her on screen, like something was going to go down.
I like the albino guy.
Let the summer begin.
Steve Ian's there, and I love that it's Ian, not Ian.
But Steve had the money, you know, so, you know, that's the way he would impress girls.
Well, hey, you got it flaunted, right?
Yeah. Steve.
My favorite from 90210, I think the hottest was Andrea. Behind those glasses lies a sex goddess.
I'm gonna party with the best of them, Rand.
Girls like that know how to party.
Yeah, I know.
Andrea, she was a big fat liar.
Andrea lived on the wrong side of the tracks.
She lived in the valley with her skanky grandma, and she'd come over and fake it like she was a Beverly Hills kid.
I'll tell you, that show kind of destroyed my social life. I would stop what I'm doing and race home to check it out.
I'm young, rich, and black. I don't live far from Beverly Hills.
I love 91.
Either they don't know, don't show, or don't care about what's going on in the hood.
Boys in the Hood was about
the internal struggle that was going on in South Central.
Hey, man, what's wrong with you?
We got a problem here?
What's up?
We got a problem.
Directorial debut of John Singleton, who went on to make No More Good Movies.
That was Cuba's first movie, right?
What's up?
Cuba Gooding Jr., one of our finest actors of our day. Boy, such great films as Boat Trip and The Damn Thing where he walks the dogs.
I actually thought the idea of having the biggest racist in the whole movie being a black cop was hilarious.
I've never in my life gotten after the cop beat my ass. He comes in and he goes, oh, cops, cops. And he goes,
kill all you.
And then she goes, I'm going to make it all better and give you some booty.
Who knew Ice Cube could act? And he stole the movie.
Domino, say about that.
And he had that Jera curl. That was a breakthrough also for him to get rid of it.
We got a problem.
He said something like, you know, need to eat too.
What the ladies eat? Gotta eat too.
People say that, you know, they didn't know the word until they saw Boys in the Hood.
Why every time you talk about a female, you gotta say or hoochie?
Because that's what you are.
I mean, I was using the word hoe in the 80s. Mostly in reference to farming.
Morris Chestnut, I hate that dude to this day. Because in the movie, his character was just like somewhere else.
I mean, if we gotta throw some heads, I think it'd be better if we're together.
Oh man, them fools ain't gonna wanna do nothing, man. They're just showing out.
These guys are chasing him with a shotgun. And he's scratching off a lottery ticket. And I remember thinking, please kill him.
Ricky!
He was a football player. And he ran for only 3 yards when he got shot.
News break.
There appeared to be, quote, an alien pubic hair floating around in my gym.
Clarence Thomas and Anita Hill had been working at the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
Ironically enough, the Equal Opportunity Employment Commission is the commission that enforces sexual harassment laws.
I could not imagine anything that I said or did to Anita Hill that could have been mistaken for sexual harassment.
Oh, dear. Oh, my goodness. What's this?
Who put pubic hair on my coat?
Is it yours?
You can't make that stuff up. Pubic hair on the coke? No.
That was the first time that I ever heard pubic hair mentioned on the news.
I was really, really very troubled by it and distressed over it.
Most of the time we do that just for fun in the office, and we never think one of our female colleagues is going to rat on us.
This is a circus. It's a national disgrace.
She was just trying to say, this is the kind of man you're putting on the Supreme Court.
He discussed some pornographic material.
So the guy liked porn.
Clarence Thomas likes to go to the movies.
This was a reference to an individual who had a very large penis.
Long Don Silver.
Nice to know we have a Supreme Court judge who's a Long Dong Silver fan. That's comforting.
Like you all don't watch porn.
Fact.
The biggest, I think, most poignant topic of the 90s to be touched upon is the explosion of grunge music out of Seattle.
Grunge means pseudo-crappy music made by people affected by adverse weather.
I thought it meant just what it was. Dirty, garage band.
None of this hairspray. We're gonna wear flannel. We're gonna talk about our feelings, but we're still gonna rock and we're still gonna get laid.
It was nice to have guys who cared more about their music than their makeup.
It's a necessity. In Seattle, you have to wear a flannel shirt or die.
I could never get into it because I got too hot. I can't be wearing a long-sleeve t-shirt and then a short-sleeve t-shirt. I'll faint!
Doc Martens were a prerequisite. You had to grow the hair long.
Here was guys who looked like they just bagged your groceries.
Kurt Cobain was completely anti-fashion and then became the definitive fashion statement of the decade.
Finally, somebody thought to marry punk rock with cardigan sweaters.
Here they are,
and the world stood up and took notice.
They were walking down the runways in Paris and Milan wearing flannel.
For a moment, Mr. Rogers was punk rock.
I thought he was such a crappy guitar player. But I thought he was a great songwriter.
I think I preferred Eddie Vedder, who sadly was sort of a grunge Michael Bolton.
He had that like cheesy devil face of like, and he's like,
you understand what he's saying? He's got marbles in his mouth, he's wearing a tattered sweater, he's got bad hair, and everybody loves this dude.
He was so not photogenic, but something about him just got me.
How women found that face attractive. I tried it after I saw Eddie Vedder. I went around, hey, babe, what's going on? You, hey, well, screw. It didn't work for me.
The grunge ended when everyone in Seattle discovered dry cleaning.
In spite of the fact that those bands were the death knell for hair band heavy metal that I studied and made my career doing, I still liked what it was about.
I love 91. Coming up, the hottest dirtbag armed robber ever.
Simon Says, everybody down on the floor.
He played a drifter who did isometrics and robbed banks.
Pee-wee's pee-pee comes out to play.
Pee-wee got busted masturbating. That's like Mr. Rogers masturbating in a movie theater. You know, a Captain Kangaroo jerking off.
So funny, I forgot to laugh.
Next on I Love the 90s, 1991. But first,
Michael Ian Black, uncut and uncensored on Clarence Thomas.
Clearly, Clarence Thomas enjoys adult entertainment. What Supreme Court justice doesn't? Rehnquist, perv. Sandra Day O'Connor, freak. Scalia, animal. You know what I mean? All these like to party.
Dance songs of 91.
Break it down. It's MC Hammer with your ultra bumping, grinding, slamming, jamming, mega grooving power dance hits of 1991. Break it down. Gypsy Woman by Crystal Waters. Calm's Diner by Susan Vega and DNA. And finally,
You're Unbelievable.
You're Unbelievable by EMF. You can't touch this. The dance hits of 1991, boy. You better ask somebody.
New Jack City was a wonderful coming-of-age story about a young man killing his people and having them be hooked on drugs. It was fantastic. You know what I mean?
You gotta rob to get rich in the Reagan era.
New Jack City was big, man. Nino Brown. Woo!
Nino Brown was the modern-day, you know, Scarface.
We will own this city.
Ooh, dark and black and mean. Ooh, it just make you want to take crack.
Wesley Snipes was cold in a different way. Cold-eyed killer. You see? These are my Wesley Snipes eyes.
Am I my brother's keeper?
Am I my brother's keeper?
Oh, he was vicious. He was nasty.
Yes, I
am. Oh. This ain't business, bitch. This is personal.
Ice-T, that voice. Man, we gonna arrest this dude.
I was teamed up with Judd Nelson, and we had to go bring down the evil crack lord, Nino Brown.
And that movie was the arrival of Chris Rock.
That was actually Chris Rock's best acting role.
Pookie, greatest crackhead role in the history of...
He was so skinny that I thought he actually was using drugs. And his lips were so ashy.
His mouth looked like a dirty toilet.
It's all crusty, and I was like, can somebody get that boy a chapstick?
None of them look like stir-fried.
Gangster was a glamorous cat, but at the end, he had a very short life, and as those guys do.
We got a problem.
Most people die all crazy. Damn, but he was like, he even fell off the balcony cool.
Later.
I love 91.
What's up, everybody?
We're calling me bad.
TikTok, you don't stop.
I want to sex you up.
That song, we play it over and over and over again. It was so funny because we're like these little kids yelling about how we want to sex you up.
That was like an X-rated song. I used to go, ooh, I'm gonna mess you up. Like, you know, I guess that was like my own version.
In my day, we had songs like Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go. Not I Wanna Sex You Up. Where's the mystery in that? I want you lubricated.
Dream on, dream away.
And then they had I Adore Mia Moore, which translates into we will be forgotten about as a band until VH1 does a special on the 90s.
I remember the way they all looked very groomed.
I think the lead singer had the spiked Vanilla Ice hair. And maybe some multicolored things going on.
It was the Kenny G looking guy.
Spanish guy, and he had long flowy hair, and he always had the George Michael 5 o'clock shadow.
And you had your token black guy.
It was the Rainbow Coalition.
So if you're gonna color us anything at all, just color us bad.
Sometimes I kind of feel bad for Color Me Bad from our generations of boy bands. They so missed the boat.
Loser.
Say we're in the desert. Say we've got a guy. We don't know what his story is.
The gal in red hot rod drives up.
Window rolls down. Beautiful woman.
Excuse me.
Are those Bugle Boy jeans you're wearing?
Oh,
yes. They are Bugle Boy jeans.
She drives on.
Cryptic?
Yes. Sexy as hell. What a wicked game.
Whenever I'm starved for compliments, I put on my Bugle Boy jeans and stand in the middle of the desert, hoping that people will stop. Things that make you go.
I think they could have changed it to, pardon me, are those cheap tapered jeans you're wearing?
Why, yes, they are.
Bugle Boy jeans were not made for brothers.
Thank you.
They were kind of tight. They made for skinny cowboys on the open range.
You know that people are carrying no backpack, had no luggage. That guy's probably still out in the desert right now looking for a freaking ride.
Vidpick.
This is another one of those videos that seemed to be prevalent in 1991, where we'd get a shirtless guy rapping about stuff.
Rico. Suave.
Rico. Suave.
And then he'll say something in Korean, like, La Viva, babe. Rico.
Heard you the first time. I got it. You're rich and smooth, like my coffee.
Rico.
That wasn't even his real name, was it?
The artist is Gerardo, who is Rico Suave, which is Spanish for one-hit wonder.
They're gonna love my appearance.
The ladies loved him, that's what I'll say.
Every woman in America thought he was either hot are really, really sleazy.
My only addiction has to do with a female species. I want like sushi.
I'm not saying every gal doesn't like to be raw, but it's kind of gross to sing about it.
The price you pay for being a gigolo.
I love 91.
Coming up, a little FaceTime with Hannibal Lecter.
I'm scary, Clarice.
And the fascist dance appeal of CNC Music Factory.
They were not asking you to dance. They were commanding it.
Next on I Love the 90s, 1991. But first,
Dirty Alternative Rocker of 91.
Liz Phair here bringing you the Dirty Alternative Rockers of 1991. Eddie Vedder, the Dirty Earnest Rocker. Chris Novoselic, the Dirty Other Guy Rocker. And Kim Thayil, the Dirty Harry Rocker. Those are the f***ing run guys of 1991, and you can't bring them home to mom.
I love the 90s.
I love the 90s. No, I know it's crazy. I just feel like I got a knack for this.
I believe.
Thelma and Louise is about two ladies, two housewives breaking out, busting out. It's a female road movie.
The way I look at it is a message to men everywhere. Treat your woman well, otherwise they will go on a crime spree and kill you.
What did you say?
I said suck my...
We got a problem.
That was sort of the beginning of girl power, the idea that two women could actually take revenge.
Guy, guess what? Sorry. Here's the penalty.
You kind of think, oh, maybe they're white trash, but they're not, because when they get all grungy and dirty, they start wearing Ray-Bans. They sort of then become groovy.
Who's who in that again?
Thelma. I think that was Susan Sarandon.
And Louise was Tina Davis.
Louise was Susan Sarandon, and Thelma was Gina Davis.
Thelma and Louise, when Brad Pitt entered my life.
His beautiful eyes and his cowboy hat. He sort of talks funny, talks with a little bit of a, almost a little bit of a lisp.
Ladies, gentlemen, let's see who wins the prize for keeping her cool. Simon says, everybody down on the floor.
He played a drifter who did isometrics and robbed banks.
Take me, break me, make me a man.
But then Thelma leaves him in the room with what? All the money.
Oh my God, Thelma, where's the money?
It's on the bed table.
Having a night with Brad, was it worth losing $6,000?
The choice is yours.
You can deal with this, or you can deal with that.
I'll write the check in 3 seconds.
With a drink of margaritas by the sea, Mama Sita.
They go a little crazy, and then they drive off a cliff. I don't mean to ruin the ending, but they do drive off a cliff. And they're happy about it.
If you're like me and you believe they got to Mexico, and then they're down there with a mariachi band, and maybe they run a bar for Americans.
Should we do it together? Yeah, girl power, yeah.
Bye-bye.
I love 91.
It started off as a show about a family, you know, that mattered, and then it ended up being a show about Urkel.
Urkel started a whole revolution. Urkelmania.
Urkel was the guy who basically adopted the Winslow family as his own.
Maybe he didn't have such a good home life.
I came over one day and never left.
Good news, I'm here.
He irritated my character, Laura Winslow.
Touching, sorry.
You could not resist this guy. I broke a lot of stuff. Told a lot of stuff.
Did I do that?
After a couple of seasons, I wondered how any actor would get away from a role like that.
People ask me that all the time. They ask me, like, do you have the inclination to do a voice now or whatever? And I'm like, no.
And I can relate to that because having done Forrest Gump, people still ask me for shrimp.
Shrimp and potatoes, shrimp burger.
Like I carry shrimp around.
That's about it.
Why do you look like that?
High water. The big feet, which led me to believe, since he had big feet, that something was going on right there.
You're a guy, and you got your pants hiked up that far. Something's going to be hurting, you know? I mean, you're going to be, like, all jammed up. Either to the left or jammed up to the right.
They did me no justice in this region. None. What an outfit.
At a certain point, we were all looking at Jaleel when he was all dressed up like, we can see your balls.
Come on!
It's not so good.
News break.
Paul Rubens, a.k.a. Pee-wee Herman, was arrested for indecent exposure in an X-rated movie house in Florida.
Hello, I'm Pee-wee Herman.
Lest we forget, Pee-wee happened in the 90s.
Pee-wee got busted masturbating. What a tragedy this was. That's like Mr. Rogers masturbating in a movie theater. You know, a Captain Kangaroo jerking off.
In the mugshot, he sort of looked like a disheveled, homeless, masturbating perv, but in a good way.
Who caught him? Do you go around a movie theater looking in the aisles to see if anybody is whacking off?
That's me in the corner.
What's he supposed to be doing in that theater if not masturbating? Entertainers have to masturbate just like everybody else. Case in point.
So funny, I forgot to laugh.
What movie was it?
It's funny that Paul Rubens was caught watching Tiger Shark. That's like not even a porno name.
Pee-wee, had you not heard of VCRs?
You tainted your legacy.
Why? Was it a double feature? How was the popcorn?
I think he butted his own popcorn in that one.
Jokes lately?
What was funny is that he got mad support.
the repetitions and rallies.
Sure enough, it turned his career around.
He made a comeback in the movie Blow. He was a gay drug dealer, which was great.
Thank you for years of entertainment.
And when you on the back of the head and the person in front of you, wipe it off. Thanks for coming and enjoy the show.
Sweet!
Here we go. The Super Bowl is underway and the kick sails downfield.
It took place in Tampa right after the Gulf War started.
And there was so much patriotism. The game itself turned out to be one of the best Super Bowls ever.
I know it was LT's last Super Bowl before he got cracked out.
You've got 140 million people watching this, and you've got this kicker, Scott Norwood, ready to kick it. He's going to be the biggest hero ever.
The quiet man of this football team, Scott Norwood. He can fire the shot heard round the world.
The kick is up, and it's
no good.
It's no good.
Wide right, it's wide right.
The Giants win the Super Bowl.
Next thing you know, the camera goes right to him. He's like,
Scott Norwood will always be remembered for missing that kick. Wide. Super Bowl. Done. 20-19.
He's a kicker. You wear the helmet with just the one bar. Nobody beats you up. Nobody does anything to you. Just go, bang. That's all you have to do.
I think Scott Norwood probably felt pretty bad because he really f***ed up.
Everybody hurts sometimes.
I would hate to see what his house probably looked like when he got back to Buffalo.
I wrote him a little note afterwards saying, Dear Scott, you tried your best. It didn't work out. You suck. And he didn't write back.
He's probably the only person who's gone on, gotten over it. It's the rest of Buffalo that's crying about it.
VidPick.
The best part of Enter Sandman is not the words or the melody. It's the intro. And it just keeps building and building and building. You're going, where the f*** is this going? And then it just kicks in and you just want to, like, dance around the room and worship Satan.
Enter Sandman was one of those, if you have epilepsy, turn the channel videos.
Everything is this. It's moment to moment to moment.
The video revolves around this creepy old man falling from a tower to the ground. It's about, like, evil dreams.
Enter light. Enter night.
Enter Sandman is not a lullaby that I would like to hear as a child. That would be a bad lullaby.
Rotten never, never land.
As hard as that song is, it's kind of like Metallica sold out because it had a melody. It's like, Metallica, stop being such please.
Now I lay me down asleep.
Pray the Lord.
There's a very terrifying moment in the video where the truck is coming down the road just as the beat drops out.
Rotten never, never land.
Or when it comes ferociously back in.
When the truck is barreling down on the bed and it hits it, he goes, boom!
The bed is destroyed and clearly the Sandman has won. And we have lost.
I love 91.
Coming up, Jodie Foster gets a face full of man gravy.
You don't want to get too close to Miggs's bars. When he calls you over, because he throws things.
Hey, girl, what's up?
Splat out.
Look at the blood!
America finds a cool new way to suffer multiple abrasions.
This right here is the worst wipeout I've ever seen.
Next on I Love the 90s, 1991. But first, Hotties of 91.
Hi, I'm Michael Bolton, the voice, with the Hotties of 1991. Pam Anderson, hottest hottie ever to improve your home and life. Naomi Campbell, super leggy hottie. And China Phillips, hot hippie offspring hottie.
When a man loves a woman.
The Hotties of 1991. 1991. Exercise caution. They may be just a little too hot.
Jay and Silent Bob, rename your favorite TV show.
Hey out there in TV land, it's the coolest cats on the planet, Jay and Silent Bob. And we're renaming your favorite TV show of 1991. Deal with the Black Nerd says the darnest things to that twink-eating cop from Die Hard. Plus, Silent Bob loves that little Urkel kid. All right, Brown Eyes, see you in 92.
I am an FBI agent!
I know, man, isn't it wild?
I am an FBI agent.
Point Break was a classic in the genre of undercover surfer cop investigating ex-president-themed mob ring movies.
I'm not a crook.
It was a guy film, you know, in the whole midst of this Pretty Woman, Steel Magnolias, Beaches, bullshit.
It's a perfectly constructed film. They're robbing banks, surfs up.
Thank you.
You can't just walk up to those guys. You have to get out there.
Keanu Reeves plays FBI agent Johnny Utah.
You're trying to tell me the FBI is going to pay me to learn to surf?
A footnote. He learns to surf in about a day, maybe a day and a half, which is impossible.
Adios, amigo!
Patrick Swayze was the head of the gang, and they used to put the president's mask on.
Sorry, Johnny. Looks like you don't get to be president.
My question is, how do you drive with these things on?
I can't see them.
You got a lot of blind spots. Your peripheral really goes away.
Rock and roll.
You're unbelievable.
Utah, give me two.
Gary Busey is a freak. I dig that guy.
I'm so hungry I could eat the ass end out of a dead rhino.
Weirdly enough, Gary Busey trying to play the steady FBI agent to Keanu Reeves's Wildcat.
People are dead. The ride is over.
The movie ends at Bells Beach, Australia.
Just let me go out there. Let me get one wave before you take me. One wave.
Johnny Utah had honor. He let him go out and surf the 60-foot waves.
Vaya con Dios.
Keanu understands because he knows the freedom of surfing.
We don't see him die, though, do we? Do I smell sequel? I think so.
Point Break 2. Paddling out.
VidPig.
The year was 1991. The band was CNC Music Factory, and they made everybody sweat.
They were not asking you to dance. They were commanding it.
Amazing record, changed dance music, floor stomping, forget it, changed the whole scene.
Everybody dance now.
I remember that video well.
More shirtless dudes rapping.
Freedom, put your shirt on.
CNC Music Factory started the whole lip-syncing phenomenon. Cheaters!
In the actual video, they had this skinny chick. But really, it was Martha Wash that sung that song. And she got pissed because she was like, you know, I was singing that part. Why can't you put the fat chick up in there?
After watching Behind the Music, I found out that she wasn't the lady singing. And I was like, whoa.
She didn't get the credit for going, everybody dance now.
The rap was a little bad, though.
I'm just the squirrel trying to get a nut to move your butt.
I did like it when the guy goes, dance till you can't dance, till you can't dance no more.
Get on the floor and get raw.
I'm gonna go get that CD right now.
I love 91.
Rollerblades. Turns out there are no passing fancy in America.
God, roller skating was cool in 91. Except it wasn't skating. We had to invent a verb for what we were doing in 91. Blading.
You go down on Venice Beach, man, a chick had a rollerblade in a little red shorts, eating a red lollipop. I like that.
I had my flashy, you know, hot pink and green skates. Come on, everybody. was one of those nerds that had on a helmet and shin guards and a chin guard.
All the skateboarders just made fun of the rollerbladers. You're cool if you don't wear helmets or pads and you smoke cigarettes.
I got a 3-year-old. He wants a rollerblade. And he said, Daddy, I want to put on my helmet. And I said, suck it up, kid. We don't wear helmets in this family. We're men. No, not on the sidewalk. Get in the street.
This sport is dangerous, and the injuries are serious.
The worst thing was breaking. I'd have to run into a tree or just fall down and look like I meant to do it.
My big ass on some rollerblades, dude, you gotta be kidding me.
I slipped over the car and then, like, hit my chin on the hood of the car, which, like, knocked me out.
This right here, is the worst wipeout I've ever seen.
I can blade down steps. I can blade on guardrails. Blade on your mama's ass. F*** y'all, I'm going blading.
Fact. In 1991, we were introduced to Garth Brooks, the goofy cowboy that came from nowhere.
Garth shows up. Nobody wants anything to do with him in Nashville. Eventually, turns out to be the biggest country star of all time.
I love Garth Brooks.
He was a pretty good piece of country eye candy.
Women loved him. Guys wanted to be with him.
We used to listen to Garth Brooks a lot.
Yeah! We would just park the pickup right on the porch and turn the radio up real loud. It's music about love and, you know, and your dog dying. I'm not big on
soldier grapes. That song, I Got Friends in Low Places, changed this nation.
Pan camera. Ready? Pan camera.
I got friends in low places.
Where the whiskey drowns and the beer chases my blues away.
It's an anthem for his dumb friends. Why don't you just write a song called Dumbass? Thunder rolls and
the lightning strikes. Style-wise, he definitely needed a makeover.
He wore that big, like, 10-gallon hat.
This guy is a incredibly offensive-looking man wearing horrible clothes.
We got a problem!
I know that he had a shirt that was half black and half white, which I thought really spoke to the duality of human nature and also looked fly. Here we go!
He was like Aerosmith country style. Turn it on!
First time I saw Garth Brooks fly out of the audience, I, you know, immediately thought, man, this guy has got balls.
To see this paunchy, bloated country superstar flying through the air like Peter Pan made us all believers.
I love 91.
Coming up, he may be a fantastic cannibal, but he's no linguist.
The thing that really bothered me was that great line.
I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
The problem was he mispronounced Chianti. It's Chianti, and it bothered me all the way. It just took me right out of the film.
Next on I Love the 90s, 1991. But first, log on to VH1.com. Get artist info, play fun games, browse photo galleries, purchase CDs and DVDs. And while you're there, cyber geek, tell us how you really feel on our message boards.
Silence of the Lambs is the story of an FBI trainee trying to capture a serial killer.
I was terrified by the movie. Absolutely terrified.
Hannibal Lecter was the most vicious serial killer of all time.
I don't believe Lecter's even seen a woman in 8 years. Oh, are you ever his taste, so to speak?
She goes and visits him in his cell, which is made out of plastic. Everybody else has bars. There was another guy who should have had plastic.
Multiple MIGs in the next cell.
He hissed at you. What did he say?
He said, I can smell your...
I myself cannot.
You don't want to get too close to MIGs' bars when he calls you over, because he throws things.
Hey, girl, what's up? Splat out.
Look at the blood!
I would have threw something back at his ass.
Closer.
He slowly, bit by bit, gives her clues into the mind of a serial killer.
The significance of the mark has changed.
I think there was a mutual respect between Hannibal Lecter and Clarice Starling.
People will say we're in love.
He takes a liking to her.
Love your suit.
And a real liking, not like she looks like a tasty morsel.
I'm scary, Clarice.
The thing that really bothered me was that great line.
I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
The problem was he mispronounced Chianti. It's Chianti, and it bothered me all the way. It just took me right out of the film.
I ate all his liver with a Chianti.
I can't get that character Buffalo Bill out of my head.
Buffalo Bill was a freak.
I like to see how serial killers dance. And when Buffalo Bill throws on the red robe and tucks his manhood between his legs and kind of shimmies about, tell me that's not disturbing.
Before I saw the movie, I had no idea that there was such a thing as a retractable penis.
Would I f*** me? I'd f*** me.
Clarice finally does track down the creepy lotion in the basket guy, who's the most deeply creepy thing I've ever seen in my life.
It puts the lotion on its skin. It does this whenever it's told.
It rubs puts the lotion on its skin, or else it gets the hose again.
Put the lotion in the basket!
Put the lotion in the basket!
So scary!
Silence of the Lambs is a movie at its heart about the importance of moisturizing.
Final thought.
1991 taught us that despite appearances, we got a lot in common. While the kids of Compton dodged bullets, the kids of 90210 dogged retail. Yet they were all residents of La La Land. And who would have thought a children's television star and a Supreme Court candidate shared a common love? It just goes to show when you put the differences aside, you finally realize we're all naughty by nature. Remember, take care of yourself and each other.